Hello and welcome back for a webinar on general neurology. My dear students, we have completed two episodes on general neurology so far, and we are today going to deal with the last episode of general neurology. And in this part, we will try to complete remaining part which is related to the nervous system. Mostly anatomy, but even physiology, because they go hand in hand. And today I have chosen for you at the first outset, and that is autonomic nervous system. My dear students, you know the meaning of this autonomic. Autonomic word comes from word autonomy. Autonomy means it is in Marathi. The thing is called as swayatta. The nervous system which has got an autonomy, that is swayat nervous system. Opposite of that is somatic. And somatic is, you know, under your will, voluntary. This is involuntary. It is not under your will. So it has got a swayatta. That means autonomy. So autonomic nervous system controls involuntary activities of the body like sweating, salivation, peristalsis, etc. Right now, I know it is almost 4 o'clock, okay, and it is quite hot everywhere. So everybody is sweating, and you are not able to stop it. Even I am sweating because I am sitting in a room, and I am plus talking plus singing also. So that is why it creates automatic, you know, activity, and that leads to a sweating. When you see food in front of you, you start automatically getting salivation, but I would prefer to tell you that the meaning of autonomic is not automatic. Automatic means swayam chalit. So this is something different. Autonomic means swayat. So your intestines are moving without asking you. So that becomes involuntary activity. And for that, there is a separate means part of nervous system, part of peripheral nervous system allotted for this purposes in your body, because there are so many of them. It differs fundamentally from somatic nervous system in having. So that means opposite of autonomic is somatic. Though not by meaning, because somatic means bodily, of the body. But that is voluntary and this is involuntary. So it differs from somatic nervous system in having. One, preganglionic fibers arising from the CNS. This is one difference. The ganglia for relay of the preganglionic fibers and the postganglionic fibers arising from the ganglia, which supply the effectors, that is smooth muscles and glands. In the somatic nervous system, the effectors are the skeletal muscles. Here there are smooth muscles, cardiac muscles and the glands. So these are the three differences here. So in contrast, in opposite to somatic nervous system, let us see what contrast we get here. The somatic nerves, after arising from the CNS, reach their destination without any interruption. So there is no, when they come out of the CNS, CNS means brain and spinal cord, they reach their destination, means their target, you know, where they want to go, without any interruption. But in case of autonomic nervous system, there is an interruption. So there is a ganglion. So we call as preganglionic fibers and postganglionic fibers. Here you can see in this schematic representation of central nervous system, everything is shown here. Central nervous system consists of spinal cord and brain. Then peripheral nervous system consists of afferent division and efferent division. So in afferent division, there is sensory stimuli and visceral stimuli. So this is for afferent, means ascending, and in efferent there is further two nervous systems, somatic and autonomic. So in somatic there is a motor neuron, skeletal muscle, which is a effector organ. But in case of autonomic nervous system, there is a further division, and that is sympathetic nervous system and parasympathetic nervous system, and the effectors are cardiac muscle, smooth muscle and the glands. Okay. And these are the effects in case of autonomic nervous system. So don't forget this schematic representation. It will help you to understand the nervous system parts. You know, only with the help of this chart, you can make out, you can make your own, you know, answers. So don't forget this chart. Autonomic nervous system is divided into two more or less complementary parts. They are not opposite to each other. They are complementary to each other. So sympathetic and other is parasympathetic. It is not sympathetic and antisympathetic. It is parasympathetic, means it is there to look after the sympathetic with the complements. The sympathetic activities are widespread and diffused and combat the acute emergencies. This is about sympathetic. Whereas the parasympathetic activities are usually discrete and isolated and combat the long-term emergencies. So the both systems function in absolute coordination and adjust the body involuntarily to the given surrounding. So that means the situation is handled by both of them at a time by coordination. So they are not opposite. That's why I say they are complementary to each other. Well, here you can see same, you know, picture in earlier. I am showing you in both central nervous system, peripheral nervous system. In case of peripheral, different division, we got somatic and autonomic. And here you got sympathetic and parasympathetic. But there is one more division that is called as ENS, enteric nervous system. Stimuli in the digestive tract, specially for digestive system, digestive organs only. So apart from sympathetic and parasympathetic, we have enteric nervous system. So autonomic nervous system is, in short, you call ANS. Somatic, you call SNS. Sympathetic, you'll call CNS. Again, you have to, you know, make clarification. Or parasympathetic, you call that PNS, not from peripheral nervous system. So you try to understand that. And actions of autonomic nervous system are on smooth muscle, cardiac muscle, and the glands. Okay. There is a provision separate for digestive organs, that is enteric nervous system. So here you can see the same, you know, divisions of parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous system in two different parts. So in case of first, I'll tell you about parasympathetic nervous system. Parasympathetic nervous system is made up of only 7 nerves. Only 7. 4 cranial nerves and 3 sacral nerves. So 4 means 3rd cranial nerve, 7th cranial nerve, 9th cranial nerve and 10th cranial nerve from amongst those 12 pairs of cranial nerves, and directly from the, you know, bottom of the spinal cord almost in the sacral flow, middle 3, S2, S3 and S4 out of 5. So only 3 of them, they make a, you know, pelvic component, and from above they make a cranial component. So it is called as craniosacral flow, and this is parasympathetic flow given to all those organs which are functioning involuntarily in your body. Whereas in case of sympathetic nervous system, there is a chain called as sympathetic chain, which is present on both the sides of vertebral column, you know, towards the abdomen. And it is made up of all 12 thoracic spinal nerves and first 2 lumbar spinal nerves. So altogether 14 of them. So these are 7 and these are 14. So altogether 21 nerves, they take part in, you know, composition of a autonomic nervous system from total 43, you know, pairs of nerves, 12 cranial and 31 spinal. Out of that, 21 make autonomic nervous system. Out of 21, 7 are parasympathetic and 14 are sympathetic, and they are having complementary action. So for example, I'll take example of heart. Okay, so heart, you can see sympathetic chain with this. There is a sympathetic supply to heart from sympathetic chain, and for parasympathetic, vagus nerve is giving contribution. So out of, you know, 4 cranial nerves, the vagus nerve has got a very huge load. So below the, you know, below the tongue area, most up to the area of your intestine, it has got work to do as a parasympathetic supply. We'll come to those points one by one, again and again. Same thing is shown you here by showing the organs here. Okay, so for example, heart, parasympathetic inhibits heart, That means it slows down heart. Whereas in case of sympathetic, accelerates heart. So wherever required, the heart is accelerated by sympathetic flow, but it shouldn't run very fast. So the parasympathetic comes to maintain it. So that is a complementary thing. So for every organs, you read it clearly, you take a screenshot, you try to compare the contribution of sympathetic and parasympathetic as far as different organs are concerned. So we'll try to understand sympathetic nervous system in little bit more detail now. It is also known as thoracolumbar outflow or thoracolumbar flow. Both are same because thoracic 12 and lumbar 2 are taking part because it arises from T1 to T12 and L1 to L2. So it says that T1 to L2 segments of the spinal cord. The medullated preganglionic fibers arise from the lateral column of the spinal cord and emerge through the ventral rami, where the white rami are connected to the ganglia of the sympathetic chain. So I showed you the sympathetic chain, how it is formed. Now the preganglionic fibers relay either in the lateral ganglia or in the collateral ganglia. Example, the ciliary ganglia, which is present in the abdomen. The non-medullated postganglionic fibers run for some distance before reaching the organ of supply. And the sympathetic nerve endings are adrenergic in nature. Adrenergic in nature meaning thereby that noradrenaline is produced for neurotransmission. At the synapse level, you know, the neurotransmission takes place. The neurotransmitters which are released are non-adrenaline. And the only exception to this general rule are the coronary sympathetic nerves supplying the sweat gland and the skeletal muscle vessels for vasodilatation. So little exceptions are also there. We have to keep in mind. Functionally, sympathetic nerves are vasomotor. Vasomotor means vasoconstrictor. They contract the vessels. And secretomotor to the sweat glands. And pilomotor means they contract the arrector pili muscle in the skin and cause erection of the hair on your skin, on the skin of the limbs and body wall. So, in addition, sympathetic activity causes dilatation of pupil, paleness of face, dryness of mouth, tachycardia, rise in blood pressure, inhibition of hollow viscera, and closure of the perineal sphincters. The blood supply to the skeletal muscles and heart and brain is markedly increased. So these are the characteristics of sympathetic activity. Thus, sympathetic reactions tend to be mass reactions. That means widespread, okay? Widely diffused in their effect, and they are directed towards mobilization of the resources of the body for expenditure of energy in dealing with the emergencies. So during those characteristics I showed you earlier, they are required for the emergencies and emotional crises like fear, fright, flight. Flight means to run away. Fight means to have altercations with somebody else. Okay, mara mari. Fear means you get that kind of impact from after looking something or after happening something. In that situation, sympathetic flow gives you all this. And this is a sympathetic chain of both the sides I'm showing you. It looks like a golden chain, no? So don't go to the image. Just try to understand the sympathetic chain, how it looks, and see that T1 to L2, how it is formed. And see, you can see the sympathetic nerves, how they are formed later on. And various ganglion, I was talking about the ciliary ganglion, you can see ciliary ganglion here. And plus cardiac and pulmonary plexus is going to heart and lungs. So this is a good diagram of a sympathetic flow. And you can see how this reproductive organs are also supplied by sympathetic part for what purposes, right up to the scrotum penis. And with this, let us end sympathetic nervous system and go for parasympathetic nervous system now. Parasympathetic nervous system is known as cranial sacral outflow or cranial sacral flow because it arises from the brain, that is cranium, mixed with 3rd, 7th, 9th and 10th cranial nerve. 3rd is oculomotor, 7th is facial, 9th is glossopharyngeal and 10th is vagus nerve. And these 4 makes a cranial part, and the sacral part is made by S2, S3 and S4, 3 segments of from the sacral part of spinal cord, sacral segments of spinal cord. Thus, it has a cranial and a sacral part. So, it is called as a craniosacral outflow. Now, there are only 7 nerves altogether. The preganglionic fibers are very long, reaching right up to the viscera. So, from beginning up to the viscera, where their destination is designated, they are very long. So, near the viscera, they will end and in the ganglia. So the ganglia called terminal ganglia are situated mostly on the viscera itself, and therefore the postganglion fibers are very short. So from ganglia, postganglion fiber will start, and it is very short because soon after coming out, there is an organ there for its destiny. Parasympathetic nerve endings are cholinergic in nature. So sympathetic nerve endings are adrenergic in nature, and these are cholinergic in nature, similar to somatic nerves. Okay, the functionally parasympathetic activity is seen when the subject is fully relaxed. His pupils are constricted, lenses are accommodated, face gets flushed, mouth gets moist. So the opposite of, see, most of the things are opposite of the sympathetic. Pulse goes slow, blood pressure falls down, bladder and gut contracting, and the perineal sphincters get relaxed. So urine is passed or stools are passed. Okay. In general, the effects of parasympathetic activity are usually discrete and isolated and directed towards the conservation of energy and restoration of the resource of energy in the body. Okay. So here it has a major role. Now I'm showing you the parasympathetic innervation, or what you call what these 7 parasympathetic nerves do. You can see 7 of the 1, 2, 3 and 4, 3rd, 7, 9th and 10th. Okay. All of them, they have got target organs to do the function. And these 3 sacral nerves, they have a work in the lower part of the abdomen, or you can say pelvis and the perineum or a genitalia. So 7 of them look after the whole affair of parasympathetic function. So this was all about your autonomic nervous system. And in short, now I'll finish the applied anatomy of the nervous system. Nervous system diseases are so many of them, but we'll try to at least highlight few of them of your interest. Because when you pass first BHMS and go to the second year with the pathology, and third year with the surgeon, and final year medicine. In the medicine, you have to study neurology much in detail, because there are many neurological diseases which we come across day by day in our practice. First one is irritation of a motor nerve causes muscular spasm. Now this muscular spasm we have seen in the study of myology. Okay, mild irritation of a sensory nerve causes tingling and numbness when it is usually compressed. Hata paela mungayane. So that is due to irritation of a nerve. I am sitting on a chair for a longer time, and sometimes I get tingling and numbness in my lower limbs. So I have to take care of my sciatic nerve to decompress it, to relieve it from the pressure. This is how it works. Okay, but when tingling and when the irritation is severe, it causes pain along the distribution of the nerve, just like sciatica. So irritation of a mixed nerve causes combined effect, tingling, numbness and pain. So this is all about irritation of a nerve, and mostly we call it as a, in terms of language of what you call signs and symptoms, we call tingling, numbness, and diseases we call sciatica and neuralgia. These words we use. Now damage to motor nerve causes muscular paralysis. This also we have studied in myology during the time of clinical anatomy of muscles, because muscles get paralyzed because of nervous system damage to motor nerve. And damage to a sensory nerve causes anesthesia or analgesia. localized anesthesia means there is no sensation, that is anesthesia. Analgesia means pain is also lost. Something you prick there and there is no pain. So that is a sensory nerve damage. And paralysis means movements are lost. So motor nerve damage. Damage to a mixed nerve will give rise to both sensory and motor losses. So paralysis we have seen. Regeneration of a damaged nerve depends on the degree of injury, particularly on the continuity of the nerve. Different degrees of nerve injury are expressed by the following three terms. So we'll go for these terms. First is neurapraxia. Neurapraxia is a minimal lesion causing transient functional block without any degeneration. Recovery is spontaneous and complete. Spontaneous means automatically recovery takes place and it gets completely recovered. But second degree is axonotmesis. In axonotmesis, there is a lesion where, although continuity is preserved, true valine degeneration occurs. Regeneration takes place in due course of time, but little faster than earlier one. And in neurotmesis, the complete division of a nerve, for regeneration to occur, the cut ends must be sutured. So I have talked about regeneration of nervous tissue in earlier episode. Now next, applied anatomy, severe pain along the distribution of a nerve is called as neuralgia. So neuralgia means pain along the distribution of the nerve area where it is supplying. And neuropathy is a broad term used for any disease of the nervous system. You have a nervous system disease and you call neuropathy. All of them are included in neuropathy. Often the degenerative diseases are called as neuropathic disease. Inflammation of a nerve is also marked by neuralgia with sensory and motor deficits, and it is called as neuritis. So polyneuritis, and these words we get and there is an inflammation because itis comes, inflammation. Next, applied anatomy is of denervation. Denervation of a part. Denervation of a part produced by trophic changes. मूर्ख आहे बघ, सेमिनार रेकॉर्ड होते हा सगळं, तू कोण मिस्टेक करतात सगळं येणार ते रेकॉर्डिंग. आय कॅन स्टॉप रेकॉर्डिंग इन द मिडल. द स्किन बिकम्स ड्राय, देर इज नो स्वेटिंग. Skin becomes smooth, there is loss of hair, and it becomes glazed. Tropic ulcers may develop, which do not heal easily. And in patients with leprosy, repeated painless injuries to the tips of the fingers and toes makes them worn out and blunted. So leprosy is a disease due to bacteria, but there is a neuropathic changes, what we call tropical ulcers. I'll show you some pictures later on. A joint after denervation becomes neuropathic, that is Charcot's joint, which shows painless swelling, excessive mobility and bony destruction. The common medical diseases associated with tropic changes are leprosy, teres dorsalis and syringomyelia. Just remember some of the name of the disease. The bed sores, usually it happens in case of a patient who is bedridden for a longer time, especially in case of paralysis patients. So the bed sores in paralyzed patients are examples of the trophic ulcers. In general, the ulcers and wounds in the denervated skin do not heal easily. A khinna padne mantat marathi madhe, or we call them as a decubitus ulcers also. So this is actually due to denervated skin cause. They do not heal easily, last for longer time. Now we will go for some pictures. This is a deformity of both the feet. Due to collapse of the midfoot arch due to Charcot neuropathic arthropathy. I talk about Charcot neuropathic arthropathy or Charcot's joint. Okay, and here you can see one tropic ulcer on the heel. Okay, so on the sole. Now this ulcer is there for a longer time, boring like tropic ulcer. Okay, it doesn't heal easily. It lasts on the body for a longer time. Sometimes it goes with the patient when the person dies. And these are common CNS diseases, because I can't explain you all the diseases today. We are not into that. We are just trying to understand the general neurology. So meningitis means inflammation of the meninges coverings in the brain, acute bacterial meningitis, acute viral meningitis, tuberous meningitis. Now encephalitis means inflammation of the brain, herpes simplex causing encephalitis. Other brain diseases are brain abscess. Okay, there is a pus in the brain, hydrocephalus, increased water in the brain, spina bifida, I mean spinal cord gets bifid, means two, it gets bifurcated. Then cerebral palsy, one type of paralysis, seizure disorder means fits, a person gets fits, aortic epilepsy, and ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. And there are many other nervous system disorders like epilepsy, chronic pain, multiple sclerosis. Even the psychiatric disorders which are related to brain, so major depressive disorder, bipolar disorder, generalized anxiety disorder, post-traumatic stress disorder, anyhow they are related to your brain. So even if they are psychiatric diseases, they are related to your brain. So you should have a good brain to not have psychiatric disorders. And there are neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease, Huntington's disease, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. Okay, these are the name of some of the central nervous system disorders and diseases. And I think that we have come to the end of today's webinar, because this science is a GI. It's telling you that we have ended today's webinar. We have also ended the study of general neurology. And this is not a ghost, okay? Don't take it as a ghost. It is your nervous system. When it is totally taken out from your body, the nervous system looks like this. So you can see the brain, and you can see the retina in the eyes, because retina are the nervous tissue. And you can see the spinal cord, and you can see all the spinal nerves, and you can see the plexuses and how they form different nerves, and different nerves go on giving branches, and it looks like this. And this is not a ghost. This is a nervous system separated from your body. Don't take it as a bhoot. It is not there for you to scare you. It is there for you to make you understand this is how the central nervous system looks like. And with this, my dear students, I thank you. Thanks a lot for patiently listening to me, even though we came today in the evening. Next webinar will be conducted in the next week with some other topic. I told you we are going to start regional anatomy now. I have finished the series of my webinars on general anatomy today, because no more general anatomy required, because we are doing it for last 2-3 months. And with this, we end today's webinar. Thank you. Thanks a lot. And see you again in the next week with a new topic. Thank you.